ओके सर।
नेक्स्ट टॉपिक इज मिसग्रुप एनालिसिस और इट्स कॉल्ड एज मिसग्रुप एनालिसिस। सो दिस इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट टूल, मैथमेटिकल टूल टू सॉल्व एनी प्रॉब्लम इन सर्किट थ्योरी। इट इज वेरी वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट टॉपिक एंड वी यूज्ड टू हैव दिस, वी विल कम अक्रॉस दिस दिस मेथड ऑफ सॉल्यूशन और दिस मेथड दिस टूल, वी बी यूजिंग दिस टूल in many parts of your electric technology. So this involves several steps. Let us see one by one. So mesh-loop analysis, whenever you get a circuit, if you want to solve that one using mesh-loop analysis, the first thing we have to do is we have to find how many loops are there in that particular circuit. So the first step of solving mesh-loop analysis is to find out how many loops are there in the given circuit. That is our first step. Once if you find the number of loops, then it says that we have to form that many or that much number of loop equations. So for example, if you have the circuit and if you have three loops, then we have to form three loop equations. So first step is to identify the number of loops in the circuit. Second step is to assign loop currents. You can give any name, I1, I2, I3 as, if you take loop 1, you can give name as I1 as loop current. So you have to assign loop currents. That is the second step. The third step is, you got number of loops and you have to apply Kirchhoff's voltage law for each loop. So for example, if you have three loops, circuit having three loops, then I'll get three equations. That equation being formed using Kirchhoff's voltage law. That is very important. Mesh-loop analysis uses Kirchhoff's voltage law. Okay, so apply Kirchhoff's voltage law for each loop and form the equations. Once if you get equations, that equations can be for solution. Even you can solve the equation using simultaneous equation, solution by simultaneous equations, or you can go with matrix. That is a very easy method. So you can go for matrix. So once you have three equations or four equations, what you can do, you can put that in a proper format in matrix. That is resistance matrix, current matrix. The resistance matrix is a square matrix, and I matrix is a current matrix, it's a column matrix, and B is a column matrix. So this is a general form of matrix form of, this is called general matrix form of mesh loop analysis. So once you bring this matrix format, you can solve for these unknown currents. If you got three currents I1, I2, I3, you can use Cramer's rule to get that unknown currents. And so that once if you know unknown currents, the last step is to find branch currents. You can find currents in each branches in the circuit. Once you know current flowing through each branches, you can find voltage drops in each components, and also you can find the node voltages. So these are the important steps to follow to solve a circuit using mesh loop analysis. So now I am going to show you how to solve. I have taken a general circuit having, you can see, three loops with voltage sources V1 and V2, and some branch resistance are given, showing there. So I am going to show you how to solve this circuit or how to form the equations using mesh-loop analysis. So the first step I told you, the first step is to identify number of loops. So you can see here, the first step, our aim is to find number of loops. I told you a loop is a closed path starting from one point and ending at the same point. So now you can see, if I start from here, I can give name A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H. If I take from A, B, G, H, A, I can make it as loop 1. Same way, I can start from B, B, C, F, G, B is your loop 2.
And similarly, C, D, E, F, and C becomes loop 3.
So from the circuit, I have identified it got 3 loops.
Of that.
So once if we have 3 loops, then we say that we got 3 loop currents. So I can assign loop currents like this. I can even read any direction. Whatever direction I take, in that direction I have to solve that loop and I have to form the equation. So I am assuming any direction you can assume. In problems and all, they may be giving the direction of the currents or they may not be giving. Other than we can give your own direction of currents, loop currents. So I am taking like this, for example, so it's taken as I1 and this is I2 and this loop current is I3. So 3 loops. So step 2 is assigning loop currents, 3 loop currents being assigned. I1, I2, I3. Now third step is we have to take each loop and we have to apply Kirchhoff's voltage law to solve that loop. So step 3 is to find voltage equation. So I take in loop 1. In loop 1, that is A, B, G, H, the voltage was available is V1, potential rise is V1 and current is I1. Now I can write the equation. So potential rise in this circuit, I told you the Kirchhoff's voltage law, I told you how to solve it, a loop. So now I can start with V1. So potential rise is V1, and now my calculation is I1 like this. That is, I am going to imagine that I am going around this loop. If I am going the same way, then as the current I1, then I put drop. If any current coming opposite to my walk, then I put rise, take as potential rise. That is, I put plus for that. I can go on. So I can see V1, current I1 is coming like this only. So I1 into R1, I can drop. So V1 minus I1 R1. And here I am considering loop 1. So the current going through this R2 is I1 minus I2. You can see here I1 is coming like this and I2 is going like this. So the current, the total current going through this particular common branch between these two loops, adjacent loops, is R2. The current going through, actual current going through R2 is I1 minus I2. So now I am assuming only loop 1. So if you take loop 1, current I1 being in consideration, so I am going the same way as I1, but current going through this R2 is I1 minus I2. So I put the drop as minus I1 minus I2 into R2. And if you come here, close the circuit. So now it's equal to 0. It's equal to 0. Now we can solve this as V1 is equal to I1 R1 plus I1 minus I2 into R1. So V1 is equal to I1 R1 plus I1 R2 minus I2 R2. So in this case, V1 is equal to I1 can take outside. So R1 plus R2 into I1 minus I2 R2 is your first equation. Now I take the loop 2. So in loop 2, thing is, it is the loop 2 is starting from B, C, F, G, and D. So first thing is we have to look out for any source out there. You could find no sources in this circuit, B, C, F, G, D. So I can put 0 for that. And I'm going to imagine that I'm going around this loop from B to C, C to F, F to G, and G to B. So while I'm walking from B to C, I can see that I'm going in the same direction as I2 is going. So minus I2 R3. And again, if I come here, it's a common branch between loop 2 and 3 is there, that is in the R4. So I can see I2 is coming like this. At the same time, I3 is flowing like this. Correct. So again, the actual the net current flowing through this R4 is since I'm considering loop 2, I can take it as I2 minus I3. I2 minus I3. But in the, I have assumed that loop 2. So minus I2 minus I3 R4. Again, now I'm going like this. I'm going like this from G to B. Now again, I can see that R2 is a branch common to both adjacent loops, loop 1 and loop 2. But now I'm considering loop 2. Hence, the current going through this will be always a difference between difference of I1 and I2. Once if I assume loop 1, I have to put it as I1 minus I2. Once if I assume loop 2, I have to make it as I2 minus I1. Anyhow, the difference will be there. The current going through this one will be the difference of I1 and I2. But once I consider loop 1, it has to be marked as I1 minus I2 in the first equation. And in this case, I have to put it as I2 minus I1. That's the only thing. And in the same direction, I'm moving. So, minus I2 minus I1 into R2 is equal to 0. That is simple. So once we can move, or one time we can move that side. So it becomes I2 R3 minus I2 R4 plus I3 R4 minus I2 R2 plus I3 R2 is equal to 0. Sorry, minus afterwards, so we put minus 6. So 0, I2 minus I3, I2 into R3 minus I2 into R4 plus I3 into R4 minus I2 into R2 plus I3. So now it's equal to 0. Now we can move that side. So it becomes I2 R3 plus I2 R4 minus I3 R4 plus I2 R2 minus I3 R2 is equal to 0. I have made one time, I have shifted to that side. So all positive becomes negative and all negative becomes positive. So now I can simplify it. I can remove all this I1 term, since we don't have I1. Sorry, I2 minus I1 into R2. Okay. So I2 into R2 plus this I1 into R2. I1 into R2. Okay. Now we can simplify it. So here it is minus I1 R2. So if you take I2 plus I2, take outside R3 plus R4 plus R2. And for this one, I3 minus I3 R4 is equal to 0. So this is your equation number 2. Equation number 2. Similarly, we can go for equation number 3. In loop 3, I'm going to take loop C, D, E, F, and C. So, in this case, I have to see whether there is any voltage source. Definitely, we got voltage source. We will find that in circuit. It is V2, correct? So, V2 is a voltage source. But I have to know whether I have to put plus polarity or minus polarity. Already in the previous class, I told you that once current coming out of the battery, then we put positive. Once current entering the positive of the battery, we have to put negative. So we have to add this one, minus V2. So minus V2, I finished voltage source. Work is finished, minus V2. Now I am going to move around the loop. So I am going to start from C to D. So once I move from C to D, conduction is the same way. I3 I am going to move. So CD, it is between CD, your resistance is R5. So minus I3 R5. and I come here from G to E, voltage source is already given, minus V2, and EF and F to C, you got one more resistance. Here it is R4, so minus, I'm going the same race as I3, but I told you the previous case, if I told you, it's a common branch between two loops, and now I'm considering loop 3, so I can put, anyhow, it is a difference between I2 and I3, so now I'm considering only loop 3, so I can make it as I3 minus I2, so I3 minus I2 into R4 is equal to 0. Now I can make all these drops that side. So minus V2 is equal to I3 R5 plus I3 minus I2 into R4. I can simplify it. So I3 R5 plus I3 R2 minus I2 R2 is equal to minus V2 is your, again you can simplify it. So minus I2 R2 plus R2 into, plus I3 into R2 plus R5 is equal to minus V2 is your third equation. So now we can make, we got three equations, voltage equations, we have solved using Kirchhoff's voltage law. Now the next step is, we have to put this into a matrix format. So now let us go to the matrix format. So the first, in matrix format, the first one is resistance matrix. So I can make this box, it's all about resistance, only resistance should be, should come in this matrix box. So you can see here, let us take loop 1, you can mark here like this, loop 1, loop 2, and here it has loop 3. Similarly here also, loop 1, loop 2, and loop 2, part just for easy identification. And here it is the unknown currents, I1, I2, I3. And here the voltage matrix, column matrix, let us see from the diagram. Okay, so the first equation, your coefficients with I1 is R1 plus R2. So here is I1, R1 plus R2 is the first coefficient. And with I2, it is minus R2. So and with loop 1, I2, it is minus R2. So minus R2. So we don't have any coefficient, we don't have any I3 component here. So we can make it as 0. This is your first equation. And in the voltage matrix, we got V1. So V1. Now we can come to second equation. With I1 coefficient, we have minus R2. So minus R2. Minus R2. And with the I2, it is R3 plus R4 plus R2, that is the coefficient with the I2. And with the I3, coefficient is minus R4. So minus R4. And here, we don't have any potential rise, we can make it as 0. We don't have any voltage source in the circuit, so it is simply 0. And for third equation, we don't have any I parameter here, I component here, I can make it as 0. And with I2, coefficient is minus R2, I can put minus R2. And for I3, it is R2 plus R5, so I can put here R2 plus R5. And voltage, in the voltage matrix, it is minus V2, so minus V2. So we got the matrix, once you got the matrix, you can solve this one using Cramer's rule, and you can find I1, I2, I3, so that we can get all branch currents in your circuit. Thank you.